Hello students, on account of COVID-19, the face-to-face lectures of CMA final of strategic cost management as well as of strategic financial management cannot be held as of now. So to ensure that we don't waste our time in this particular period, and we put it to productive use. That is what we learn in costing, making the best use of time, making the productive use of time. I am here, CA Prabodh Naik, your faculty for Strategic Financial Management and Strategic Cost Management. We have decided to try to put up videos for your studies, and it will be as good as a live lecture, where we will be putting up short videos of 2 hours, 3 hours duration, as if it is a lecture, and we will be explaining to you the concepts one by one till the lockdown ends and we can make a face-to-face lecture possible, which will be quite soon. But till then, instead of wasting our time and getting tension as to how to approach the exams, how to study for exams, we will utilize this opportunity to ensure that the students as such do not suffer because of the lockdown. You stay at home, stay safe, and we will reach to you at your house. What I plan to do is, I plan to put up short videos of every chapter, and I will be putting it up on YouTube, which will be available for a duration of 48 hours. So within 48 hours, even if you can't see it at a particular point of time, within 48 hours, at any point of time, you can go through the video and the concepts which are there will be explained to you. You can make short notes of this in your notebook accordingly, so that once you meet face to face, then the things can go on very smoothly. Technology is with us, and therefore we intend to make use of technology to reach out to students at your convenience so that you don't suffer because of the problems that are taking place all over the world. Education should not suffer. Gaining of knowledge should not suffer. So this is my view to you, that as and when you get time, the lectures are uploaded. You have 48 hours with you where you can go through the lectures, make your own notes. And when we meet face to face, obviously, we will be sorting out any difficulties that you are having. Even over here, you can reach out to me and we can find out a way to solve your issues, to solve your problems on the net only. So, I hope this particular effort of CMS and our chairman, sir, Chandrasekhar Rao, is going to be beneficial for you in your studies. Happy study. Today we are going to start with strategic financial management topic, that is security analysis. So today's topic will be security analysis. In brief, I will give you the explanation of the theoretical concept, and as and how we go deeper into the subject, we will be taking up the questions, the problems also. Till the lockdown period is over, we intend to continue in this way, but of course we also have to see your comfort level, whether you are able to understand via this medium. I'm sure all of you are having a smartphone. You can make use of the smartphone. You can go to YouTube with the link and see the lecture. Alternatively, if you are having a net facility and you are having a laptop at home, you can watch the lectures on your laptop also, through the internet, if you are having a good internet speed. So I think that is, these are the two options available to you, that is laptop as well as your smartphones. So let us make use of technology and make productive use of the time that we are staying at home. Convert your house, one room of your house, or the space around you as a classroom, and you will find that the lectures are as interesting as a classroom lecture. And you also find that you are the most special student for me at your house. So let us start with the topic of security analysis in strategic financial management. So ready students, we'll be starting with the concept of security analysis, as I said, as I told you. And therefore, the first thing that we are going to do is meaning of security. What is the meaning of a security? And from the point of view of an investor, what does he consider security as? For him, what is the meaning of a security? And for that purpose, let us start with the basic term, that is meaning of security. Why do we use this term security? We use this term security because for the company, the company which requires finance will raise finance in the form of various financial instruments. Like you have an equity share, you have a debt capital, right? So equity shares, debt capital, that is debentures. Then some companies issue what is called as corporate bonds. So in that particular way, the companies come out with different forms of financial instruments, bonds, corporate bonds, debenture certificates, then equity share certificates. So these are all what? These are all financial instruments which are helping the company to raise finance. Company goes to a bank, it raises a loan. So if the company raises a loan, what is that loan actually? That loan is actually nothing but a financial instrument. There is a loan agreement, so that is a financial instrument. That leads to borrowing of the company. Okay? So any business that requires finance will be raising this finance in the form of different financial instruments, and these financial instruments are called as security. So security is a financial instrument or a promissory note or a method of lending or borrowing or a source of contributing to the funds needed by the corporate or non-corporate body. From the point of view of investor, I am going to purchase the shares of a company. So when I purchase the shares of a company, for me as an investor, I will be taking it as an investment. So now let us try to understand ki what is the meaning of investment. Investment kya hai? For us as an investor, an investment means that I am sacrificing something and in the present moment and keeping it for a later stage. For example, I have 10,000 rupees as surplus income with me. This 10,000 rupees I can spend. I can take my friends out to a restaurant. I can enjoy. I can take my family out for a picnic. So I can utilize this and spend the money of 10,000 surplus that I'm having. Alternatively, I can say that no, I want to sacrifice my present spending. I want to cut short on my luxuries and I want to keep it for the tomorrow. So sacrificing something now and keeping it for tomorrow with the intention of making some profit, making some gain, where risk is involved. Whenever we are looking at profit, risk is involved. Higher the risk, higher the returns. So risk is involved in getting that profit. But I want to keep it for a later stage so that I can make some profit out of it. Which means that there is a time involvement. So I am saving today, I am investing today that money and keeping it for a period of say 3 years or 5 years or 10 years with a particular objective in mind, with the objective of making profit, growing the money, which involves a time period. So in an investment, there are three things. What are the three aspects to an investment? Time, today's sacrifice, and the prospective gain that is likely to take place, which involves some amount of risk. So I have got the definition. Investment may be defined as the process of sacrificing something now for the prospect of gaining something later. Thus, there are three aspects to an investment. There are three parts to an investment. Time, today's sacrifice, and a prospective gain. So these are the three elements. So So sometimes we ought to know what are the elements or what are the things that make up an investment. So what are the three things? It is time, sacrifice, and prospective gain, that is involving risk factor. So we have seen what is the meaning of security, but security is from the point of view of the corporate or the non-corporate body that is raising the finance for its purpose as capital or as borrowings. Okay. What are the different investment alternatives that we are having? Or I'm looking at it this way, what are the different ways in which a company can raise finance? Alternatively, I'm looking at it from investors' point of view, what are the different avenues or what are the different sources of investment for an investor? Okay. So from that point of view, if I start making a tree out of it and I try to see what are the different ways or what are the different financial instruments which are available to me, I have the first branch of the tree that is coming in the form of non-marketable financial assets. Now, what are non-marketable financial assets? Example, if I'm investing in something like bank deposits, okay, fixed deposit of a bank, that is one of the non-marketable financial assets. It cannot be sold. It is my fixed deposit. Okay, then a post office deposit. Third is company deposits, corporate deposits, what we call as public deposits and showed in the balance sheet of the company in the form of public deposits. Or we can have provident fund deposits. Okay, so these are the non-marketable financial assets. Then the second part or the second source of investment for an investor is in the form of equity shares. So if I look at it, equity shares is the second source of financing a corporate which wants to raise equity shares. But there are different types of equity shares now. What are the types in which I would classify them? That is, as an investor. As an investor, I would say that I'm investing in blue chip companies' shares, top company shares, one of the best 5 companies, one of the best 10 companies, the top 10 companies, the top 5 companies. Second is investment in growth shares, which are helping me to increase my value, my wealth, which are appreciating in nature on a day-to-day basis. The value of the shares are increasing. And the third is those shares which are giving me a good returns in the form of dividend, that is income shares. So blue chip shares, growth shares, and income shares. Now this classification is from the point of view of investor, not from the point of view of company, from the investor's point of view. Different ways in which we can do this. Okay, now third source of investment for me is going to be in the form of bonds. Now bonds, I'm having detailed study to do of this at the final level. I have to do the valuation of bonds. I have to find out how to calculate the value of a bond and different terms which are going to be used in the concept of bond valuation. Bonds can be in the form of government securities, public sector undertaking bonds, that is what is called as PSU bonds, and then we have debentures. In India, corporate bonds, now if you see this particular part, debenture, it's a corporate bond. In foreign countries, they call it as corporate bonds. In India, we call it as debentures. These are the three different ways in which we can raise capital for the company. For us, it is an investment in the form of bonds. Fine? Okay. The fourth source that I can say over here is going to be money market instruments. Now, money market instruments, what are the different forms of investments that we can have? We will be doing this again in detail when we are coming to that particular topic of financial instruments which are available in the money market. Here, I will just mention the examples of money market instruments. I have what is called as treasury bills, commercial paper, and certificates of deposit. These are the three financial instruments, money market instruments that we are having, which can be used for investment purpose by an investor, which will help to raise finance for the companies. Okay, so we are now discussing the different alternatives in the form of investments. Likewise, the best form of investment that we can think of where we can invest and not also have a big risk involved is what is now very popular in the form of mutual funds. Mutual funds, sahi hai, advertisement you must have seen. Yes, and that is another form of investment. But again, in mutual funds, we are having different types of mutual funds. We are having equity-based mutual funds. We are having debt-based mutual funds. And we are having balanced mutual funds. In equity-based mutual funds, you have 80% of the funds investing in equity shares, 20% in debt. In debt-based mutual funds, you are having 80% in the form of debt and about 20% in the form of equity shares. And in balanced mutual funds, you are having balance of investment in debt as well as in equity. Okay, that is your mutual fund investment. Then another form of investment which we tend to forget is life insurance policies. That is also an investment where it is a double-edged weapon with us, where I can invest in life insurance policies for the purpose of risk also and for the purpose of keeping my funds in a safe place where I will require those particular funds at my retirement stage. So life insurance policies is another form of investment, right? Then the other form of investment that we have is real estate. Properties, if I invest in properties, then that is investment in real estate. So many times we invest in land, we invest in properties, we buy large plots of land. So that is nothing but investment in real estate. Then we have investment in precious objects. Investment in the form of gold, investment in the form of silver, investment in the form of antique pieces, okay, antiques which are there. So those are also nothing but they are also a form of investment for us. Okay, and then the last part, that is financial derivatives, which your CMA final SFM paper is going to be full of. We are going to learn what are financial derivatives in SFM. Correct? So these are the different ways in which we can have the investments, which we can have the securities for the company. So we were talking about security analysis. We have seen the meaning of security now. So let us now slowly move to the meaning of security analysis. What do we mean by security analysis? Security analysis is the first part of investment decision process. It is the first part of investment decision process. Why do I call it as first part? Because whenever I want to invest in a particular security, I want to invest in the shares of a company, will I just go to the market and purchase the shares of any company that is available? No. So obviously, I will be trying to understand the nature of the investment that I am going to have. That means I will try to analyze the different companies' shares which are available in the market, and I will try to find out which is the best investment for me. So I am going to do analysis of the security before the investment is done. Okay. Second is, security analysis is primarily concerned with the analysis of a security with the objective, with a view to determine the value of a security. Okay. Now, determine the value of a security for what purpose? So this is very important for us. What is the objective? The objective is to determine the value of a security. Whether that particular security is going to be beneficial for me, whether that particular security is going to serve my purpose, my objective. What is my objective? It differs. It may be, I told you, capital appreciation is one of the reasons why I may want to invest. The shares of a company are, the market value of the share of a company may be increasing at a rapid pace. So because of that, I want to take advantage of that capital appreciation. So I'm investing. So for that purpose, I should know whether my security is priced properly or not. If it is already at a very high level, then I cannot invest in the shares because I may feel that tomorrow the price may fall. If it is overvalued, then the prices are likely to fall. If it is undervalued, then the prices are likely to increase. So these are the things that we are going to learn in analysis. The analysis means that we are going to find out this particular aspect. Whether it is undervalued, whether it is overvalued. I will purchase when it is undervalued. I will sell when it is overvalued. So finding out the value of a security is the primary objective for which I'm going to do security analysis. Okay. Now, security analysis involves two types of analysis. The first one is called economic fundamental analysis, and the second one is called as technical analysis. Fundamental analysis. What is the meaning of fundamental analysis? Fundamental analysis is made up of three parts. Fundamental analysis is made up of three parts because whenever I'm investing in a company, I have to analyze in a systematic way. If I'm investing in the shares of a company specifically, then I need to know what is the economic environment in the country. What is the economic environment in the world? Is it conducive? Is it favorable for investment purpose? So that is economic analysis. Analysis of the country's economy. Analysis of the world economy. Finding out whether it is the right time to invest in the shares. Whether it is the right time to invest in bonds. So the first thing that I will be involved in is economic analysis. I will be coming to that. We'll do the deep study of what is economic analysis and so on. What are we going to study in economic analysis? So the first step is economic analysis. Second is industry analysis. I find that yes, the economic environment is most suitable for me to invest. It is most favorable for me. It is a very favorable investment time. For example, now stock market, you have seen Sensex is falling. So I may take this opportunity for investment purpose because the price of all the shares are coming down. So I may decide to invest now so that after the lockdown is over, after the coronavirus problem is over, when the markets increase, there will be capital appreciation and I can sell the shares at a future date, make a profit out of it. So for that purpose, I have done economic analysis. Now find that, okay, the environment is good. It is the right time now for investment. Second, I will say, okay, now I want to invest. Where will I invest? Whether I should invest in IT sector, whether I should invest in infrastructure sector, whether I should invest in the power sector, whether I should invest in the garment sector, whether I should invest in the pharmaceutical sector. Now, because of this virus, everybody has become conscious that research and development has to be done. We have to find medicines. So maybe that pharma industry is going to pick up. Isn't it? So I'm doing industry analysis now. Which sector, which industry is going to be beneficial for me now to invest in? So you can see that we are doing analysis. That is what is analysis. Isn't it? Okay. Third is company analysis. Okay, I decided I'm going to invest in company, the industry, that is pharma industry. Which company I'm going to invest in? GlaxoSmithKline? Whether I'm going to invest in Indoco Remedies? So which particular company I'm going to invest in? Because I cannot invest in industry. I've analyzed the industry, I've decided which industry, but I want to now know which company's shares I'm going to purchase. So I will do company analysis, which company is performing well, which company is giving dividend, shares of which company is going to be appreciating in value, which is the most tradable security in the market. Company analysis. So this is what is done by fundamental analysis. Second is economic analysis. What is economic analysis? A study of the rate of growth in GDP. That means now I'm breaking up that fundamental analysis. Three parts were there: economic analysis, the industry analysis, and company analysis. I'm doing economic analysis. Study of what do I do when I'm doing economic analysis? I told you whether investment environment is suitable, favorable for us, whether there is a proper growth in GDP, whether employment is increasing, unemployment is decreasing, whether we have a favorable balance of payments position as far as import-export is concerned, whether there is high inflation. Okay, so those are the factors to be considered in economic analysis. Second, study of economic policies of the government, import-export policies of the government, fiscal policies of the government, wage policies of the government, Third is a study of world economic trends. What is going on in the world? In the Middle East, there may be a crisis that may lead us to petroleum products increasing in price. There may be some problem in North Korea because of the ruler there. So there may be some global disturbances which may affect the prices of certain commodities. So I have to study the world economic trends and how it is going to impact my Indian economy. Then we do industry analysis. As I told you, industry analysis means I'm now going to decide as to which particular industry is going to be more suitable for me for investment purpose. So I give you the example, engineering industry, pharma industry, power sector. So industry analysis. So usme hum log kya karenge? First, implication of projected growth in GNP on various industries. How the GDP, how the GNP is going to be affected by different industries. How the power sector is going to contribute. How the pharma sector is going to contribute. How the garment industry or the textile industry is going to contribute. So how different companies, how different industries are going to contribute to the gross domestic product, to the gross national product. Implication of various government policies on wages and prices. Restriction on import of certain raw materials. Implication of government fiscal policies on various industries. Degree of dependence on imports. Price and income elasticities of the end product, final product. Income elasticity, price elasticity, demand elasticity. So all these things come under industry analysis. Then we have company analysis. What do we do in company analysis? Analyze the company's details. Study the trend in the company's shares movement. Okay. Then analysis of the cost structure and break-even point of the company. Leverage and coverage ratios of the company. Whether the company is having a high leverage, low leverage. Okay. Then we check the ratios. Which ratios? Leverage ratios. Debt service coverage ratios. We check the fund flows and the cash flows, right? So that we will be checking. Estimation of the dividend that has been paid by the company in the last 3 years. Profits of the company in the last 2 to 3 years. Price earning multiple, price earning ratio. Assessment of quality of assets. Whether the assets of the company are having a good value, whether they are productive. So productive use of the assets, productivity ratios. So all these things I'm going to assess. Assessment of quality of management, very important. How good is the management in running the company? How good is the management in controlling the cost of the company? How good is the management in framing and implementation of policies of the company? So all this comes under company analysis. So as I told you, fundamental analysis is made up of three parts. What are the three parts? First, I decide economy, whether it is favorable or not favorable. So economic analysis. Economic analysis barabar hai. Now it is favorable for me to invest. So I will decide which industry to invest, which sector to invest. After I decide the sector, after I decide the industry, I will now think as to which company to invest in. So these are the three analysis that we are going to have. What is technical analysis then? Technical analysis is details of the company analysis on a broader basis. It is a study of the market data in terms of factors affecting supply and demand, prices, volume of trading, etc. It is a simple and easy method of forecasting behavior of share prices. The financial data and past behavior of share prices of a company. So I'm using the financial data of the company to analyze the company. The movement of the shares in the last 2 to 3 years, behavior of share prices. And the various charts which are available. If you go to NSE and BSE websites, BSEindia.org and NSEindia.org, if you go to those sites, you will get the pattern of the movement of the shares in the last 1 month, in the last 52 weeks, like that, in the last 1 week, So the behavior of the share price movements, whether the industry is facing any technical problem like labor problem or some taxation policies affecting the company or some import export policies affecting the company, and as a result it is affecting the demand and supply schedules. So this is called as technical analysis. Okay. Investors who use technical analysis start checking the market action of the share, whether it is favorable or unfavorable, whether the shares are undervalued or overvalued, because I have to take a decision whether to buy or sell. If it is undervalued, I will buy. If it is overvalued, I will sell. Okay. Now we come to the concept of intrinsic value. Students, what is the meaning of intrinsic value in accounts is different, is slightly different from how we use this intrinsic value term in financial management. So I need to stress upon the explanation to this particular point as to what is intrinsic value. Okay, intrinsic value is the value of a share for me as an investor. So what I will be doing is that I will try to find out what are the future cash flows that are going to arise from a particular investment in a particular share or a debenture. In the case of shares, it will be dividends. In the case of debentures, it will be interest, which is coming in the regular form. So these are the cash flows that I'm expecting in the future for the time period of 3 years or 5 years for which I'm going to remain invested. So all these future cash flows that I'm going to earn, plus when I sell the share or when I sell the debenture at a higher value, the capital appreciation that is going to arise, that is also a part of my returns. That is also a part of my cash inflow. So ye sab cash inflows jo hai, all these cash inflows, uska present value kya hai, uska aaj ka date ka value kya hai, that is intrinsic value for. So it is a present value of all future cash flows, which includes dividends, which includes interest, which includes capital appreciation. Now, present value calculation mein you have done financial management at inter-level. Present value calculation mein, we are going to make use of a discounting rate. Now, since that discounting rate, now discounting rate is what it is actually my minimum expected rate of return. This particular minimum rate of return expected is going to change from year to year. Therefore, the intrinsic value is also going to change year to year. Okay. So, second point is the intrinsic value is likely to change from year to year as the factors determining this value. Now, I said factors. So, one of the factors is discounting rate. One of the factors is expected dividend, because dividend is not fixed na. If I am talking about shares of equity shares of a company, uska dividend fixed to nahi hai. So since the dividend is not fixed, my estimation of dividend, so that is a factor determining this value. It changes from year to year. Last year I must have got a good dividend on the company's shares, but this year it will not be possible because of COVID-19. All the companies are affected, whichever sector you belong to. So, uski hisab se, on that basis, my rate of earning is going to change. My discounting rate is going to change. Therefore, the present value will also change. And this present value, when it changes, the intrinsic value is changing. So, as I said, it is the present value of all future cash flows. Did you follow? Okay. Now, third thing that I want to say here, as far as intrinsic value is concerned, a security is underpriced if its market price is below its intrinsic value. Its market price is below its intrinsic value. Intrinsic value kya hai? My expectation of future cash flows discounted at my expected rate of return. तो जो इंट्रेंसिक वैल्यू आएगा whatever intrinsic value you are going to get. That intrinsic value is what I feel is the worth of a share. Again, I am repeating, intrinsic value is the, understand carefully what I am saying. Intrinsic value is the value which I feel is the worth of a share or a debenture. So if I say that intrinsic value as per my calculation is 95 rupees. Intrinsic value as per my calculation is 95 rupees. And this share is available in the market. This is the market price rate, 80 rupees. Market price is 80 rupees. And intrinsic value, matlab, the worth that I have for the share, I price, I value the share. I feel that the worth of that share is 95 rupees. Lekin market mein wo 80 rupees mein mil raha hai. It is available in the market at 80 rupees. I say, arey, it is cheap. Actually, its value 95 hona chahiye tha. It should have been 95, but it is available at 80 rupees. It is cheap, so it is underpriced. It is underpriced. But if the market price of the share is 100 rupees, market price is above the intrinsic price. Mere hisab se, according to me, the market price should be, the worth of the share is 95 rupees. But market price is showing 100 rupees. Sorry, Baba, it is very costly. I can't afford to pay 100 rupees for a 95 rupees share. So for me, it is overpriced. It is overvalued. Okay, so did you understand meaning of underpriced and meaning of overpriced, or undervalued and overvalued? So when the when is a security underpriced? If the market price is below intrinsic value. When is a security overpriced? When it is above its intrinsic value. Market value is above the intrinsic value. Why I am stressing on this is because if it is underpriced, mere hisab se 95 hona chahiye, it is available at 80 rupees. I will say buy the share, Baba. I will buy the share, and if it is overpriced, I will sell the share and book my profit. Samajh mein aaya? Okay. Now, next thing that I want to say, since the intrinsic value of a stock is the present value of all future cash payments, the discount rates, this is very important, discount rates used by different investors are different. Now, why I am telling you this point? I am telling you this point because if I find intrinsic value of a share, according to me, is 95 rupees, and market price agar hai, to agar ye market price 105 rupees hai. So what will I do? I will buy or will I sell? Should I buy or should I sell? I should sell, na? Because mere hisab se uska price hona chahiye 95 rupees. It is worth 95 rupees. But market price is 105 rupees. I am having 10 shares with me. So I will sell all the 10 shares, book the profit. Profit kitna hai? Profit 10 rupees ka profit hai. The profit is 10 rupees. 10 rupees per share. I have 10 shares with me. 10 into 10, 100 rupees profit mil gaya. Isn't it? So if the market price is more, I feel that market price is more, sell. Because according to me, the worth is 95. Sell. But when I sell, there should be a buyer, na? I should have a buyer for 105 rupees. Now you are buying the share for 105 rupees. I'll say, are you, why you are buying the share for 105 rupees? Because according to you, this is according to me. This is according to you, the intrinsic value may have been 115 rupees. Ye aapka hai. This is your estimation. You say that intrinsic value is 115. It is worth 115. So according to you, market price kam hai. Market price is less. It is underpriced. For you, it is underpriced. For me, it is overpriced. So I am going to sell. You are going to buy. You are going to buy. So what is my intrinsic value is going to be different from what is your intrinsic value, because the discounting rates are different. And what are discounting rates? Discounting rates are nothing but expected rate of return. ये आपका और मेरा अलग अलग हो सकता है. Your expected rate of return may be different from my expected rate of return. Isn't it? So we come to the conclusion. The same asset has different intrinsic values for different investors. That is the reason why some investors are willing to buy and some are willing to sell on the same day. Now you understand why I am willing to sell a particular share, because for me it is overpriced. Why you are buying the share from me if it is overpriced? Because according to you, it is underpriced. Have you understood? So this is the concept of intrinsic value, which will be utilized by us in all the topics that we are going to do. So intrinsic value ka matlab financial management mein yehi hai. And this is the use of this intrinsic value concept. Okay? So in this first lecture of mine, in this initial lecture of mine, I have tried to explain to you the concept of security and security analysis. Okay, now one thing I want you to do, and that is go through all these points, and as you are going through all these points, keep a notebook with you. Okay, make notes of all the important things that we have written down here, so that it becomes easier for you to revise. Of course, we are coming out with the material. Okay, CMS is coming out with the material, the institute will be coming out with the material. But till then, I require to summarize the points and remember the points. So for that purpose, I would request that you turn back the video, watch the video once and twice or thrice again, and make notes of important points that we have discussed here. Now, if there is any problem, you can put it up over there. When you are watching the YouTube, comments ka possibility hai, comments ka option hai. So you can write your comment over there, either that you like the video, that you are comfortable with the video, or if you are having any query, you have not been able to understand something, you want me to re-explain something, okay, or some clarity is required, some concept is not understood, write in the comments part. We will come back in the next lecture with the solution of that, with the explanation of that. So this is how I intend to make the lectures interactive, so that there is no one-way communication. You are also having the opportunity to give me the feedback on how you are feeling with the lectures. For you, it is the first time, but for me, I have been doing this for the last so many years. And every year, with every video, I have been trying to simplify the things in the form of PowerPoints, in the form of presentations, which will help the students to understand the matter in a simpler way, in an easier way. So these are the efforts that we are taking here. I, as a faculty of CMS and our chairman, sir, with his permission and with his guidance, we are going ahead with this particular platform of reaching out to you in your days where you are sitting at home, so that your time is not wasted and at the same time you benefit from this particular time. So as I said, now your classroom is your own house. You are the most privileged student, because you are the only student that I am talking to. Every student will feel the same thing, that I am talking only to him. So you get this benefit, you get this feel that yes, I am the only student, I am the special student. Isn't it? So this is going to be one of the best methods of reaching out to students. And I am sure you are going to appreciate the efforts that we are putting in. And I am sure you are going to give me the good feedback of this. So we conclude the lecture, first lecture here. If you are comfortable, we will start putting out more lectures in this format so that we progress ahead in our studies for CMA final. Thank you. Stay at home. Stay safe. God bless you.